Good evening and welcome again to another edition of Couch Potato. I'm Peter Couch Potato. Australian television, or television in Australia, was once regarded as amongst the top 200 television industries in the world. Certainly in the top 300. Four-ish. The question is it still? Well, tonight we ask the question, Australian television, can we get it ring? Right. What precisely do you think is wrong with Australian television?
You can always pick a fake, can't you? That kind of thing would never happen on a real Couchman show. Never at the ABC, would it?
No way!
Oh, never, no. Good evening, everybody, and thanks for coming along for this final Couchman over Australia. Yes, after 4 years, we're bringing down the curtain tonight. I haven't counted exactly how many shows we've done in those 4 years, but it feels like a lot. We've certainly covered a lot of ground, and some thousands of people have sounded off about an awful lot of things. Now, the remarkable thing, though, is that in those 4 years, none of them has ever come to blows, and no one's lost control. Except there was once when I almost did. We went up to Canberra to cover the political party of the year. That was 1989. There was a big political reunion of past and present politicians at the Lakeside Hotel, and we went along. But Sir John Gorton did too.
Well, you're insisting that I sit there, are you? Why don't you give me a chance to ask you? To give something to you. Why won't you? I mean, Al's doing it. Why won't you?
Will you sit down, please?
You won't ask me at all.
Will you sit down, please, Sir John?
No, you're a very strange man. If I don't sit down, why won't you ask me? Why won't you just sit there and let me say something?
Look, Sir John, if you don't sit down, we'll just stop. Now, will you sit down,
please? OK, let's stop.
Will you sit down,
please? Let's stop now. Is that OK? Are you going to stop?
Am I going to have to get you evicted?
Yes, get me evicted.
OK, will you sit down?
Get me evicted now. Come on, get me evicted.
Well, what do you do in a situation like that? No one's going to do that tonight, are they? That was one of Sir John's more memorable media appearances, and I certainly won't forget it. But little glitches like that aside, we do seem to have covered an incredible range of issues during the time we've been on air. I mean, everything from the economy and Australia's...
Yes?
See, if you go from Channel 2 to Channel 7, there's five holes in the middle. And then if you go from 7 to 9, there's two holes, and from 9 to 10, there's no holes. How come that?
Maybe that's the problem. but let's move on to another theme that's certainly been a central part of many of our programs. In fact, I think it's been a central part of Australian life over the last 4 years. This is a very different country now than it was back in April 1989 when we first came on the air. We have lived through the worst recession in memory. And a lot of people have been on these programs talking about how it's affected them. People in business, people on the land, working people. And underlying all this, there's been the central issue of economic restructuring and making Australia internationally competitive. Now, we've heard a lot about the level playing field in the last 4 years, haven't we? But we heard a lot more about it 2 years ago when we took the program up to Dalby in southwest of Queensland to talk to some of the farmers of the Darling Downs.
You can import peanuts from China, $300 or $400 a tonne, less than what we sell our peanuts for. Mm-hmm. In the case of navy beans or baked beans, you can import cans of beans from Hungary on the shelf for 45 cents as against the Australian product for about 75 to 80 cents. Now that doesn't only affect the farmer. I mean, there are people down in the cities that make those cans and make those labels. But through federal government policy allowing these things to come into the country, we all miss out.
Okay, so you're arguing that you want some protection.
I have no choice. I cannot compete with that sort of imports into this country.
Okay.
Now, I asked the federal government and all politicians, do they want peanut growers or do they want navy bean growers? If they don't, for God's sake, bloody well tell us so that we can try and get out of it.
I take your point, and this probably sounds a very cruel thing to say at a time like this, but if Australia can buy it cheaper from somewhere else, why should we pay you people to go on producing it?
Peter, we'll end up eating coal. About the only thing that we can do cheaper is produce coal, we'll end up eating it.
Are you people now seriously suggesting that you should be protected? Are you suggesting that Australia should be subsidising you people?
If you see
the successful contemporary economies in this world and have a good examination of them, you'll find that there are some import quotas to protect industries like that, and you'll find that there is some tariff protection. Now, why have we in Australia, as Rod Saul said before, a very small drip of water in a big puddle, why have we got to be the only free traders who are silly enough to jump into that dangerous pool?
But what do you say to an argument like that, Phil Riven?
Well, I think we've almost lost touch with what the real issues are. I think, firstly, on the level playing field, it never was a level playing field in the world, and it never will be. The best example of that I can give is that when Australia federated in 1901, it meant that your interstate tariffs and restraints disappeared. And yet Tasmania had a devil of a job trying to grow bananas in competition with Queensland. Queensland couldn't compete with Victoria on ski fields, and later on, of course, Canberra couldn't, you know, run an ocean regatta or compete with anybody. In other words, which simply means that I think if we're looking for some mysterious level playing field, it's never going to be there, because there are advantages that you have with a town or a state or a nation, and there are some where you make your own advantages.
Yeah, but sure, see, these people are saying, look, Australia is a drop in the ocean, and we're loonies if we think we can go out there and try and compete with the rest of the world on anything that even resembles a level playing field. We'll all go broke.
It's precisely because we are a small nation that we can't afford to put up barriers around us,
exactly,
that we don't have the opportunity for exchange within our borders because our economy is small, that we must exchange with the rest of the world. The level playing field analogy was about Australia, and what it tried to demonstrate is that you shouldn't take from one Australian and give to another. Because by doing so, I mean one industry and give to another, because by doing so, you don't create employment, you just shift it round, you don't create any employment at all. In fact, you destroy a bit, you certainly destroy lower living standards, and what's more, you also corrupt the process of government. That's how WA Inc. came up, by taking from one industry and giving from another.
You don't go along with that, Sally Brown.
I've watched it. I can tell you now, in the last 10 years, I have seen this nation slip. We have the highest, more unemployed people in Australia than ever before, 41% of youth in some areas. Yes. We have a dollar dropping all over the place. We have 75% of product on hardware stores being imported. We have 50% almost of supermarket stuff being imported. We used to be able to grow potatoes, grow tomatoes, we still can, but there's no protection. Make chalk, make cheese, make everything. It comes into the country. We have in the last 10 years developed an international debt from $15 billion to $170 billion. And if you want to pay it off, put a dollar a second on the table for 5,300 years and another $500 interest, and these loopy people in Canberra are still maintaining their right, and there are empty factories, increasing unemployment, increasing people cast, wasted human resources, cast out all over Australia, and they're sitting there saying they're right. And there is evidence of disaster throughout this nation, not caused by protection, caused by people that don't understand global common sense. I'll give you an example of level playing fields. Our citrus industry. In Brazil, they pay those pickers $40 a month, $1.30 a day. They then drop the tariffs. Orange juice comes in here from Brazil with a 5% tariff. They then say, get efficient. What do we pay our workers $1.30 a day? Big
deal. Or do we get out of the citrus
industry? Then they say, export it, and we try and get it into Japan, and it's hit with a 40% tariff. This is a joke. This is criminal. These men in Canberra and all their friends will die with debt on their hands, and I hope they do so that we can get on and be productive like we were 10 years ago.
What's the key to the productivity?
Common sense!
Well, tell us how to do it then. You've got to fix the labour market.
I've been productive for 21
years.
Well,
what about the rest of the nation? The labour market's got to be attended
Could
to.
I
the taxation
tell you?
System.
I'll tell you very
you
simply.
Anyone can do a summation of what
get
the problem
rid of
is.
The 17
What's the
government
solution?
Departments that stop me
well,
being productive
well, why don't
would
you
be
go
a
and
good
read
start.
Fight back? Look, what you've got to do is identify the problem.
Read shutdown,
you've done,
honey.
You've identified the problem, but you haven't said what
I
the solutions are.
I can give you 15 answers when he comes back next year.
You have to identify what the solutions
we
are.
We can do it if we're left alone.
No one has intended
we
to undertake the solutions.
We can do it. We have great Australians. The government doesn't help.
Look,
they're trying to kill us off. They've
the
increased the debt, and we cannot ever pay it back,
okay.
ever.
Diarmuid Hannigan, I'll let you come in next.
because
sorry, I'm normally
I've sold containers of cheesecakes to Japan. I've made them myself, and I've set up a business over the last 4 years. And the first container of cheesecakes we made and sent to Japan cost our company $120,000. We sold it for $90,000. We lost $30,000. The federal government, out of its taxes and charges on labour and the flow through, made $40,000 out of that container. So my little company was 40 grand down the tube. The next container I made, I lost $30,000 on, and the federal government made $30,000 on. The next container, I lost $20,000 on, and so on and so forth, until now I'm making a small profit.
Yeah.
The federal government has made $400,000 out of our activities. I've made $20,000.
Yeah, but Dermot, I think the point is, in your business, you are now making a profit, but you have demonstrated that Australia can sell cheesecake to the Japanese.
That's right.
And you're competing with the rest of the world.
That's right. We can compete, but we could be selling a lot more cheesecakes if we'd had some sharing by the Australian government.
Just let John Hyde come here. He's been nodding his head furiously.
Okay, look, I mean, this is a terrific story, but you'd compete so much better if you, every time you replaced a motor vehicle, you didn't pay an additional $4,000 to subsidise an industry that isn't internationally competitive. The reason now that you're getting close to the margin that you're not internationally competitive is that you're carrying on your back the burden of industries that are not internationally competitive, including orange juice and motor vehicles
definitely not. I'm one of the industries that John would be violently attack. I'm from the footwear industry. Now, in the footwear industry, it is not inside the level playing field. It is internationalist level playing field. And they have levelled half of it. You can't level the other half. The other half of the level playing field, so-called, is 50 cents an hour they pay the worker in China. 50 cents an hour, 20 times less than we pay our workers here. So that level playing field is never going to be level. It is a total myth.
So and John Hyde and, Phil Riven, perhaps, this time, are we going to try and compete with that sort of situation? Well, are we just going to get out of footwear altogether?
Well, we should get out of industries where you're not going to compete over a long period of time. I often wonder if we shouldn't go back to basket weaving.
So we stop making and growing stuff.
Give Phil Cleary.
These arguments have been discredited. The idea that at a particular point in time you determine what comparative advantage is absurd. We know that historically. Countries have worked through that one. Japan didn't do it. If Japan had followed these policies, it wouldn't have existed in the form it has today. It planned, it had a program. It said we can make particular industries competitive. You don't take it at a certain point in time and say, there's the point, there's the starting point, it can never go anywhere. And look, the free traders represent particular vested interests, and that's one of the problems with this argument. You get the mining sector, which pushes a particular line. Plus, also, ask the free traders a cultural, philosophical question. What industries do they want in Australia? What does Australia actually have to look like? What do they want to make? And what do they want to distribute in Australia? Because it is absurd the way they talk. They have no sense of history or culture. It's just this absurd level playing field, this absurd international competitiveness, and it doesn't work, and other countries are not so stupid.
Right, so then, well, look, that's a good point that we should go to. Is the extension of this argument, if we can't compete with the rest of the world in some industries, we should get out of those industries and go into industries where we can compete?
Is the answer quite...
Tell us which industries can compete. The answer quite simply,
Peter, is yes. The fact is that every time you impose a cost on an imported product, you put up the cost to those industries that are competitive. Now, we have got industries in Australia that are competitive. You're sitting next to one.
Three quarters of the manufacturing.
And why are you loading? Well, the one I'm in, the grain industry, the wool industry, the meat industry.
Where is it? Mining? Look at the wool competition.
Just hang on a moment. The fact of the matter is that those industries that I've just described are competitive. And the absurd thing, look, take a very absurd example in this country. Wool, meat, grain, iron ore, tourism. We're competitive. The cheesecake industry that's just been described, that's a competitive industry because he's made it competitive. Now, why the hell should those industries be loaded up with extra cost? What we have to do is move all of our industries into the area where they are competitive, not load extra cost onto those industries that are now competitive. It'll put them out of business. It is not a zero-sum game, taxing your competitive industries to subsidise industries that will never make it. And if you look at Phil Cleary's argument a moment ago about planning ahead. We tried to have five motor car manufacturers in this country, less than the size of New York State. The Americans must think we're a joke. We could not make those things competitive, and in the process, we put out of business industries that could have been.
Phil, do we, in very brutal terms, say, yes, look, no navy bean industry, no footwear industry, because the Chinese or the Hungarians can do it so much cheaper, we just can't do it. We'll go into something else.
One thing, Peter, I must do is the greatest lie that's been foisted on Australia in the last 4 years is to say that the foreign debt which we've got, which is now 160 billion, is due to the fact that we're importing more goods more than exporting. That is a lie. For the last 20 years, we have run a surplus on our exports over our imports of goods, and we are now $8 billion in front of where we were in 1972. The 160 billion is lost totally out of trading in services, nothing to do with goods, and it's there in black and white in the Bureau of Statistics figures. One of our fastest growing industries virtually didn't exist 30 years ago, and that's called tourism. It is now twice the size of agriculture, which is 204 years old. So there are career paths and there are jobs, and there's hundreds of thousands of them. And I think that we ought to be aware also that 9 out of 10 new jobs in every developed economy in the world today is in the service industries. And if we think we've got to go back and, you know, resurrect industries that were sheltered workshops for years when we've got a bonanza of new jobs available to us in the future, we'd be crazy. And I think parents ought to know there is a stack of new industries out there and we shouldn't worry about the old ones.
Right, well, look, you've demonstrated very clearly tonight that Australia still hasn't resolved this argument, not in 2 years, not in 4 years. And I find that a bit frightening because we're really debating Australia's future here. And it's going to be fascinating, I think, perhaps in 10 years' time, to look back on this discussion tonight and see what we make of it in the light of where Australia's gone between now and then.
We have a couple of television people who used to own television stations in the audience, Deirdre and Alf Thimbleton. Deirdre?
Yes, well, Alf left the water board with a lump sum of $47,000 and we were going to put it into a little business like a milk bar, but then our bank manager said he'd be prepared to lend us $600 million to buy a TV network.
And what did you see as the advantages of owning a television network?
Oh, well, we didn't have to prepare sandwiches.
And how did your investment pay off, Deirdre?
Well, what with bank interests, we owe about $2.5 billion now. So, on balance, I think we probably should have stuck with the milk bar.
She's been looking for a way out for a while.
There is somebody in the audience who claims to be a channeler who can fill themselves with the spirit of a 4,000-year-old television executive from Atlantis. And I think, Madam Tofu, if you could just fill yourself with that presence.
I am channeling now.
Fox 474, you pick up a drink here. No, not you, Fox 44. This is not your pickup. You are not the first cab on the ring.
We have to go, but thank you so much for coming along tonight. And I have had such a wonderful time over the last 4 years listening to people like you talking every week, and I think I'm going to miss it. Thank you so much indeed. And thank you to all of those who've watched us and joined in from home. I know you have because you've written and told us so. And it's been just great tonight to be here with our crew in Melbourne. Some of them, Sonna and Daryl and Roger and a few of the others, they were here on the very first show we taped 4 years ago. It's been just a pleasure to work with such pros, people. And, of course, the people in the office upstairs who've done all the hard work to make these shows work, I will never forget you. They've made me look good week after week. They've tried to make me look good week after week. And I do appreciate everything. Thank you, everybody, and good night.
In 1969, I thought I was pretty radical. I was 21 years of age. I look at my son, who's now 18, and a lot of the kids that I work with today, and they make me look like a conservative.
Females like romanticism in relationships. Males have difficulties understanding that, and they have difficulties knowing what to do with that.
This is not music. This is noise. There is no recognisable beat. There is no melodic line. It's a gimmick. It's a vast gimmick.
When I kissed you and called you sweetheart, you ain't
nothing but a hound dog. Elvis doesn't need any impersonators to carry his name on, because Elvis's name went down in history many, many, many years ago.
Kathy, why did you leave Chances?
Because I wasn't prepared to do nudity.
Right, well, that's a pity, because Couchman's nude tonight. But anyway, go in and enjoy your night.
Right now.
Please go in and enjoy yourself.
Rash. Rash for fantasy. When the moon is in the seventh house.
Like, with all the good things that we need to take from the 60s, it's not a matter if we don't have an identity in the 90s. It's like we need to learn and we need to build on it.
I do want more muscle. I do want to get bigger, but I still want to retain my femininity. I don't want to go overboard. I've got a long way to go because I've only been training for 2 years, so I've got lots to achieve.
I appeared on the then top-rating talent show New Faces on the Nine Network, and the so-called judges saw fit to award me a paltry 42 points out of a possible 100 for my interpretation of the sensitive ballad Love Is a Many Splendid Thing. Are you familiar with that?
Well, I...
Suffice it to say that the heat was won by a singing poodle who had absolutely no microphone technique whatsoever.
Good. Well, I think you've made your point, so if you could just...
Love is a many splendid thing.
Well, that's about it for Couchman, and what an effect it's had on us all. Peter's given us politics and sport, humour. But above all, he's refused to do the one thing that nearly every Australian television host does when they get their own show: sing. Thanks, Peter, we appreciate that. What else has he done? Well, he's challenged, he's provoked, he's informed. He's also shown us just what can be achieved with really good hair care products. He's also done the show from overseas. He did it from Ireland and Gallipoli, South Africa, Bali. He didn't do a show from Bali. Just lay on a beach and read a Wilbur Smith novel, but you get my point. A lot of people have tried this sort of show and failed. So why was Peter so successful? Impartiality. The ability to ask questions without prejudice or personal slant. I'll never forget his show on psychic phenomena. He'd let each person have their say no matter how outrageous. He'd listen intently, wouldn't interrupt, and then as soon as they turned their back, he'd go... Yes, Peter Couchman is an ABC icon. An icon along with Bill Peach or Clive Hale. Bananas in pyjamas. I, on behalf of everyone at the ABC, want to thank him and wish him well in his next venture. What is it? Well, let's just say the Sheepdog Show is going to have a new host next year. Mum's the word on that, right? Good night.